ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors at the ETF Store and sponsored by Legg Mason. Legg Mason's sponsorship is not an endorsement nor a recommendation for any product or service. Legg Mason Investor Services LLC is not affiliated with the ETF Store, ETF.com, or any of its affiliates. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. All investing involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. The ETF Store owns and is responsible for all program content. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Legg Mason is a leading global investment company committed to helping clients reach their financial goals through long-term actively managed strategies. Legg Mason offers a broad range of equity, fixed income, alternative, and cash strategies worldwide. It is comprised of a diverse family of specialized investment managers, each with their own independent approach to research and analysis, and has over a century of experience in identifying opportunities and delivering astute investment solutions to clients. To learn more, please visit leggmason.com.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Connor will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
All right, great show today. As always, I want to thank the exclusive sponsor of ETF Prime, Legg Mason. One of the hottest areas of the stock market this year is marijuana and marijuana-related companies. If you look at the ETFMG Alternative Harvest ETF, which owns companies involved in the cannabis space, MJ is the ticker symbol, that's up over 40% year-to-date. It's been at the top of the ETF leaderboard all year long. Now, interestingly, MJ had been the only way to play marijuana using ETFs, but they recently got some competition. A couple of weeks ago, Advisor Shares launched the Pure Cannabis ETF. This has a great ticker symbol as well, YOLO, you only live once. And there are a couple of other marijuana ETFs in registration with the SEC, which I'm guessing will launch here in the not-too-distant future. In just a moment, we're going to discuss this area of ETFs with ETF.com's Laura Krieger. There's a lot to this space, just given the regulatory environment, right? Marijuana is still classified as a Schedule I drug. It's illegal at the federal level in the U.S. So there's a lot that goes into launching a marijuana ETF and investing in this space. And on that note, later in the show, we'll actually be joined by the portfolio manager for the Pure Cannabis ETF. Dan Ahrens with Advisor Shares is going to take us much deeper into this world of marijuana investing and explain how Advisor Shares is navigating everything here. But Connor, I think this entire space is simply fascinating because I guess like any fledgling industry, you have a lot of optimism on one side, and then there are also a lot of naysayers. So there's been talk of a bubble here, like we saw with crypto and Bitcoin back in 2017, people who would say you can always grow more marijuana, right? So what makes it unique? But on the other hand, of course, that's what tobacco companies have done forever, right? Sell something that grows out of the ground. And I think they've done pretty well. And the other thing here, too, is, look, if the regulatory environment shifts, because there does seem to be a lot of growing support for marijuana legalization, some of the revenue projections tossed around for this industry are enormous. So to me, this is just, again, a fascinating area. It has the look and feel of a classic startup industry.
You know, there's always this kind of talk when any new industry shows up where a lot of vocal supporters on one side and certainly naysayers on the other. But the fact that we're talking about marijuana makes this topic even more polarizing. And look, I don't have a crystal ball, and we have no idea how this is going to play out from an investment perspective, but it's hard to dispute that this is a rapidly evolving space, and in my opinion, it's not a question of if, but it is when the federal government will finally legalize marijuana recreationally. But, you know, we've seen a massive sea change in the public support for legal marijuana. It's hard to believe that that will not eventually, you know, come to fruition on the federal level. But, You know, Nate, we're talking strictly at this point about recreational pot, and frankly, there are a lot of potential applications for marijuana and its derivatives beyond that, right? For pain management, less addictive, right? There's an opioid crisis in this country, and there's a lot of hope that some derivatives of marijuana could be used for that. There are parts of marijuana that can be used that have nothing to do with getting high, that they're being looked at by pharmaceutical companies and the like. So I'm sure we're going to get into all of that with Dan here shortly. But, you know, taking this back to the ETF world, it's good to see a new fund launch to give MJ some competition.
I agree.
As they were the only game in town for a little over a year now. So, look, competition is never a bad thing. And consumers, or, you know, in this case, investors, will usually end up winning.
Well, and you mentioned the growing public support for marijuana legalization. Look, that's reflected in the fact that we have ETFs on market now, marijuana ETFs. Could you even have imagined these things 10 years ago existing?
It
would have never happened. All right. Later, we'll also be joined by Todd Rosenbluth, Senior Director of ETF and Mutual Fund Research at CFRA. Todd's always one of my favorite guests. And so we're going to go around the horn on a bunch of different topics, including marijuana ETFs. And we'll also touch on everything from ETF fees to what ETF stories Todd is tracking for the remainder of the year. It should be a fun conversation. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit etfprime.com or you can find me on Twitter at Nate Geraci. Also, if you enjoy ETF Prime, we would greatly appreciate if you could leave us a quick review on iTunes. All right, let's talk marijuana ETFs with ETF.com's Laura Krieger.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com, the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
People have been saying there are too many mutual funds since the 80s. For all the talk of smart beta, they haven't pulled in huge assets. The active managers are showing up in the ETF space.
Laura, let's start with the AdvisorShares Pure Cannabis ETF. This has a tremendous ticker symbol, YOLO, right? You only live once. This launched a couple of weeks ago. It's the second marijuana ETF on the market after the ETFMG, Alternative Harvest ETF, ticker symbol MJ. Now, we will be doing a deeper dive on this later in the show with the portfolio manager, Dan Ahrens of AdvisorShares. But I do think it'd be helpful just for the purposes of our conversation. Give us a quick overview. What can you tell us about this ETF?
Sure. So in my opinion, YOLO is the marijuana ETF that investors kind of always wanted all along. It's a pure play fund. 80% of the fund is invested in quote unquote cannabis companies, which I should say are companies that get half of or more of their revenues from activities in marijuana or hemp. And that is a big difference from MJ, because cannabis companies in that fund are only one of five pillars of the potential investable universe. So there's, at any given time, a good quarter or even more of MJ that isn't directly involved in cannabis at all. It's more forward-looking plays like tobacco and alcohol and so forth. So that's kind of a big distinguisher between the two funds. The other big one is that YOLO is actively managed. It's not tied to an index. And I think that's going to be kind of a huge advantage in this space, because as we all know, as Connor was saying earlier, marijuana is a rapidly evolving space with developments that happen every day, sometimes every hour, you know? So you need somebody, I think, that it would be a big advantage to have somebody who can really stay on top of those news stories and those developments, rather than having to be tied to an index that, you know, rebalances every quarter and so on. So there's a lot of other distinctions about YOLO that I'll let, you know, Dan get into later on. But those are the two biggies that strike me, the fact that this is actively managed and it is more of a pure play.
Something else I got a kick out of was YOLO priced one basis point cheaper on the expense ratio than MJ, 74 basis
points. Sure, that was a coincidence.
Right. ETF war knows no bounds. Laura, obviously custody always comes up in this discussion around marijuana ETFs. And I guess first, for investors who haven't been following the marijuana ETF story from the beginning, can you explain the basics on custody and some of the issues MJ ran into? And then I want to talk about maybe what YOLO is doing, you know, different here.
Sure. So custodying stocks is something that every ETF needs, is somebody to custody the stocks, which is basically somebody to hold them for the fund. And the Reader's Digest version of what happened here the problem is that pot is still illegal, right, at the federal level. So big U.S. banks with federal licenses, with federal charters, FDIC insurance, they don't want to piss off the Justice Department by explicitly holding these illegal stocks, you know, stocks that are involved in a federally illegal business, for a fund that's focusing on a federal illegal substance. It could be bad news for them. So MJ came into being in kind of a weird backdoor way where the issuer, ETFMG, they converted an existing fund into a marijuana fund. And given the particular way that they did it, they didn't have to get approval from their existing custodian bank to do this change. So the bank was, let's say, not happy about that. And after a few months, ETFMG and U.S. Bank, they parted ways. For MJ, ETFMG signed it up. They signed up a new custodian, Wedbush Securities. They're a regional bank that's never custodied an ETF before, and there have been a few trading blips associated with that. So in contrast, that to YOLO, right? YOLO's issuer, Advisor Shares, they work very closely with their custodian bank, BNY Mellon, to create the fund. The issuer, they pre-cleared with the bank any stocks that they could potentially invest in. They also pre-cleared those securities with the SEC, with the exchanges. They got everybody on board who could potentially object, that they got them on board. So in so doing, I think maybe they made it easier for other funds to come into the marijuana space as well, because they did everything by the book.
But Laura, to be clear here, is MJ currently holding any companies deemed illegal at the federal level? And I guess if not, why can't they just use a custodian like BNY Mellon?
They are not holding any stocks that are federally illegal. Like that's what they've been very careful about that. They you know, I want to be careful about that too. They're not investing in anything that's illegal. But just the way that they went about going through this process with their fund, I think the custodian bank just didn't appreciate not being let in on that and not, I'm not a fly on the wall, right? Like I wasn't there for those conversations, but I think there was just some concern about the way that they were going about building their portfolio. Mm-hmm. that you know, raise some red flags.
So on that note, I know when investors are doing due diligence and MJ comes up in the conversation, this potential issue of custody risk is floated about, right, just because of the backstory here. But this ETF has now been trading for, about a year and a half. It has over $1.2 billion in assets. Do you think this custody, quote-unquote, issue is really a non-issue now?
That's a really good question. I doubt that MJ is going to lose Wedbush overnight. I doubt they're going to lose their custodian. That was a real fear there for a while. It might still happen, but it's less likely the longer this fund trades and trades, you know, with no major blips. But that's the issue here. Wedbush is not necessarily an experienced ETF custodian, and you're starting to see some of the trading issues. You're starting to see some trading issues arise. For example, MJ only has a handful of authorized participants on hand to trade the fund. I believe they're on the record a few months ago as saying they only had about four or so. Compare that to YOLO, who has 20 on hand. And that, you know, that number of APs, that's going to make creates and redeems easier to affect in YOLO, meaning you should see smaller trading premiums in that fund. Compared to MJ, that translates into lower costs for investors. So there is a real world impact here from the custodian risk. It's not just esoteric. So it is something that investors should keep in the back of their mind.
All right. Looking at the marijuana ETF market overall, do you see YOLO taking market share from MJ, or do you just see the overall pie growing as the marijuana market presumably continues to expand and mature?
That's a really good question, and I wish I had a crystal ball to answer it. But in my opinion, I think we're going to see the pie growing. So I think there has been some pent-up demand. I don't know how much, but I think there has been some from investors who wanted an ETF option in which to invest in marijuana, but they saw maybe the risks associated with MJ, and they didn't want to, you know, put their money in that vehicle. So my prediction is that for the next few weeks, you're going to see assets in YOLO and MJ grow, maybe simultaneously, or you're not going to see YOLO stealing much money from MJ. And that's actually what we're seeing right now. We're seeing flows over the past week or so. YOLO is attracting money. MJ is attracting money. YOLO is already at $34 million in assets under management in just a week. So I think there's room for both here.
Well, and on this note, I know there are a couple of other marijuana ETF filings in the hopper with the SEC. Can you tell us anything about either of those?
Sure. So there are two that should be coming out in the next couple of months if everything goes to plan. So we've got one from Innovation Shares. And the big distinguisher there is that they would use a broker-dealer instead of a bank to custody their marijuana stocks. Using a broker-dealer as a custodian is totally a legitimate option. Broker-dealers already custody marijuana stocks for clients in other contexts. However, it might add a few extra costs in terms of compliance. So it remains to be seen whether that would have any impact on shareholders. I don't know. Then there's also a fund and registration from Amplify. That would cover a lot of the same ground as YOLO. It's also an actively managed fund, except this portfolio would be managed by a fairly well-known marijuana expert, Tim Seymour, who is also, he's a host on CNBC. He's kind of a big cannabis evangelical. So they would have that name associated with their fund management.
All right, Laura, we have just a couple of minutes left here. I mentioned at the top of the show the performance from MJ so far this year. It's up over 40%. Anything in particular that has been a catalyst here in terms of the performance?
I think it kind of goes back to how well Canadian marijuana companies are doing. They're going on a tear right now. Aurora Cannabis gained something like 83% in the first quarter. Canopy Growth gained 61%. These stocks are still just poo through the roof. I think one of the things I think is interesting about MJ's performance is that, like I said earlier, a fair amount of the fund is in tobacco stocks. Tobacco did pretty well, too, last quarter. Philip Morris gained 32%. Altria went up 16%. Like, these are good numbers. They're not marijuana good, but they're pretty good. So I would be interested to see how a pure play performs without that allocation to tobacco and alcohol and see if it could go even higher.
No, I completely agree. I think this is going to be fascinating to watch, and especially if we get these other two cannabis-related ETFs coming to market in the not-too-distant future, just watching the performance variation among, theoretically, these four ETFs, again, will be really interesting. Laura, always appreciate the time. You cover this space as well as anyone. Thank you for joining us this week.
Thank you for having me on.
That was ETF.com's Laura Krieger. And again, stick around because later, AdvisorShares portfolio manager Dan Ahrens is going to spotlight that AdvisorShares pure cannabis ETF. And we'll also get his thoughts on the overall marijuana market as well. First, let's take a break. And when we come back, CFRA's Todd Rosenbluth will join us to go around the horn on a number of different ETF topics, including his biggest ETF surprises so far this year. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Nate Geraci alongside Connor Kelly. And now joining us via phone from New York is Todd Rosenbluth, Senior Director of ETF and Mutual Fund Research at CFRA. Todd, always a pleasure having you on the show.
Thanks, Nate. Good to be with you and with Connor as well.
So, Todd, we are going to bounce around on a number of different ETF topics today. And first, we were just visiting with ETF.com's Laura Krieger on marijuana ETFs. As you know, AdvisorShares recently launched the pure cannabis ETF. So MJ now has some competition. Any strong views or opinions on this space? Do you think this AdvisorShares ETF has the potential to compete with MJ?
Well, I think it's great that we see competition. It gives investors, it gives advisors more choices when they're comparing and contrasting ETFs instead of just flocking to the only choice that's out there. I guess a couple of things to note. The new product, YOLO, charges 1 basis point lower. That's 74 basis points versus 75 basis points for MJ. Again, basis points is not the end-all, be-all. When we took a, we do not cover either ETF, so let me be clear on that from CFRA's perspective. But when I looked at the holdings from the fund's websites, there is a notable difference between what you'd find in the portfolio. That's much more than the fees. And, of course, the stocks drive an ETF's performance, not the underlying fees. And so your larger holdings in YOLO are about half the weighting that you'd find in MJ. And not that it's coincidental, we'll find the same thing happening. The larger holdings in MJ, like Aurora Cannabis, which is a roughly 10% weighting in MJ, it's a roughly 5% weighting in YOLO. So stocks are going to drive these respective ETFs. We don't have an opinion on Aurora Cannabis right now, but if we did, or if an investor did, you'd certainly want to be on the right side of that 10% versus 5% weighting and look under the hood.
Todd, I completely agree 1 basis point shouldn't drive the decision-making in investing in any ETF. But do you think these ETFs will just go back and forth on fees, or do you think maybe some other competition comes in and perhaps undercuts them both?
Yeah, it's inevitable that 74 basis points is still a premium fee. You know, we've seen thematic ETFs that have come out for 60, that have come out for even lower than that. I think the 5G product that came out earlier this year, FIVG, is even lower than that. So now the door is open. The SEC has greenlit a new ETF. In fact, they actually greenlit the first of these ETFs since MJ had a backdoor way of converting from a Latin American real estate ETF a little over a year ago. It's inevitable. There's other products that are in the filings. I'm sure you talked about that with Laura. She's been covering that very well at ETF.com.
I like your use of the term greenlit in talking about marijuana ETFs. Todd, on this topic of ETF fees, there are a few recent stories I'd love to get your quick hot take on. The first is SoFi. So they recently launched the first free ETFs after fee waivers. And I know you saw this Wall Street Journal piece about how SoFi essentially forced some of their customers into these ETFs in the portfolios they manage for these customers, which isn't the end of the world, right? A number of asset managers do this. But the issue here was they may have forced some taxable capital gains in the process of doing so. The question I have is, do you think this sort of highlights the potential conflicts of interest that can exist with asset managers using their own funds and just the overall pressure the ETF fee war is putting on everyone?
So I don't view it as a conflict of interest. I think it's inevitable that we're going to see asset managers that are launching products use those products within their fund family as long as they adhere to various criteria and there's a due diligence effort. And so these are low-cost products that SoFi offered. They are well-constructed based on what we can see of them when we look at the holdings. We, again, don't cover this yet, but when we look at the holdings, you're going to be get a growth tilt towards large cap, well-known companies from within. I think it's perfectly appropriate that they are using these products the same way that we've seen JP Morgan use the products there, the same way that Schwab's own ETFs are available and used within Schwab portfolios or Vanguard's are used in Vanguard portfolios. What I do think it highlights, though, is fees, again, should be the end-all, be-all for investors. If you're going to trade down away from something that now that costs 3 or 4 basis points to something that's zero, you're obviously incurring a cost in making that trade, and there, you know, from a trading cost perspective, but also you're potentially incurring taxable costs as well. And so we do think these low-cost products are going to gather assets, but we think investors need to understand what they're getting, understand how it fits into their broader portfolio, and make sure they're working with their asset management, whoever's running the portfolio, to make sure that they're owning what they want to own.
You mentioned JP Morgan and on this topic of low-cost products, what about the J.P. Morgan Beta Builders U.S. Equity ETF? This thing costs 2 basis points. It's the cheapest ETF on the market, not using fee waivers. Are you surprised this doesn't have more in assets yet? I think right now it's a little over, what, 30 mil, maybe close to 35 mil. I thought for sure this thing would have $1 billion invested by now.
So I think it will have $1 billion invested in it likely by the end of the year. J.P. Morgan has historically seen money move into these beta builder products in the third or the fourth month of its history. We've seen that with Japan, with Canada, with Europe. The European products, BBJP was, I guess, the first of those. BBCA was the Canada product. Now, some of that money, as I think we talked about beforehand, came in from J.P. Morgan's own clients. The money was moved in, and then it's gained a following afterwards. There's due diligence that needs to be done to have that happen. I would expect that. So I think I've said on Twitter that we think we're going to see the SoFi product hit $100 million first of these two, and then we're likely to see BBUS hit $1 billion first between that. These are going to be very popular products, despite what we at CFRA think that investors should go beyond the expense ratio. Cheap is winning out across the board. It continues to be a number one factor when investors are doing their homework, if they're doing homework at all, when choosing an ETF. We'd expect these products to be popular, and we think we're going to see more of these products that are in the low single-digit basis point range.
Our guest is CFRA's Todd Rosenbluth. Todd, a couple of other fee stories I wanted to ask you about. First, last week, Vanguard formally announced fee cuts on 21 ETFs. And I saw a stat from Bloomberg's James Seifert that this impacted $662 billion in assets and will save investors an estimated $88 million annually. So just like that, nearly $90 million is going back into investors' pockets each and every year. What's your reaction when you hear numbers like that?
I think it's amazing for the investor experience. These are well-established products from Vanguard. We're not really seeing fee cuts the way that you would from other products, where you're seeing strategies that are not popular that the asset manager is trying to jumpstart demand. These are products where the fees are coming down because of scale. So Vanguard, on an annual basis, like anybody else, reviews the fees, but because Vanguard is set up differently, the fees go down when the assets come growing in the door. We periodically will see the fee actually tick up if there's ever outflows on a year-to-year basis. You've got 3 and 4 basis point products within the equity and the fixed income space. You could build a well-constructed fund-to-funds portfolio using these Vanguard products the same way you could with an iShares suite of products or a State Street suite of products. It shows why we're continually seeing money moving in to ETFs because of the broad asset allocation approach. You know, we think it's wonderful, and we wrote about this when it first came out. CFRA did a couple of months ago when the prospectus came out, or the annual report came out, and we saw a lower fee for VOO and a couple other Vanguard products.
Todd, you alluded to Vanguard's business model, and obviously right now iShares is the leader in the ETF space, but can anybody compete with Vanguard's business model longer term? And I'll tie this into the last fee story I wanted to ask you about, which was we recently saw the iShares Core MSCI EFA ETF, ticker IEFA. It surpassed its sister fund in assets, the iShares MSCI EFA ETF, EFA. And what's noteworthy about that is IEFA has an expense ratio of 8 basis points. And EFA an expense ratio of 31 basis points. But these ETFs basically do the same thing. And look, clearly iShares understands investors are going to eventually move to the lower cost product. But is this a way of competing with Vanguard? I know Bloomberg's Eric Balchunas tweeted, if you don't cannibalize yourself, Vanguard will.
Right.
Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I think, you know, iShares launched these products, IEFA and a similar product, IEMG, the emerging markets product. These were lower cost alternatives to the EEM product, and you mentioned the EFA. And they were doing this, we think, in response to Vanguard having success with lower cost products. So iShares now offers them two at a similar fee structure, different exposure, of course, which we can put aside for the moment that you shouldn't just choose between IEFA and Vanguard's developed markets ETF. But this is in response to where the industry has gone. I think it's, again, really interesting to see that more institutional-oriented investors are choosing the lower-cost product that is tied to an MSCI benchmark. You really have to be competitively priced or be highly thematic to be having investor interest. And again, these are the topics we're talking about for the right reasons. This is where the money is going into thematic strategies and broad asset allocation products.
Todd, moving away from fees, you talk a lot about the importance of investors needing to look under the hood of an ETF, right? Look beyond fees and really make sure they understand what it is they're buying. And on that note, you recently wrote a couple of really interesting pieces. One explained how investors don't necessarily need to wait for some predetermined period of time before investing in new ETFs, like 3 years or whatever. And then the other piece was that investors don't need to wait for new ETFs to reach a certain level of assets before investing, especially for ETFs holding something like larger cap U.S. stocks. My question is, do you think new ETFs are getting a fair shake from investors? You know, we were just talking about Vanguard chopping fees and these iShares ETFs. It's obviously extremely tough for new ETFs to compete. But do you think there's also perhaps an investor education issue here with new ETFs?
So we at CFRA rate about 1,500 ETFs with a overweight, market weight, or underweight opinion. So we cover everything regardless of its asset size, regardless of its length of time. It's typically a couple of months before we start covering an equity or a fixed income ETF. So we're trying to give investors and advisors the tools to be able to choose products. In that piece, one of the pieces you alluded to, we highlighted there's 9 products that are less than 3 years old that have $1 billion in assets. Now, some of them are the JP Morgan beta builder products we talked about, but not all of them are competing on fees. The other piece you talked about, we wrote that investors should be looking at products regardless of assets under management. We highlighted products that could hit the, that are below $1 billion in assets, but that we have a positive view on, the products from WisdomTree, products from Invesco that are, we think, are not getting the right investor attention when we look under the hood and we look at the cost structure. There's a lot of great products that are out there. There's some good new ones that are coming out. There's a lot of noise that's coming out as well, but it is in the investor's best interest to choose beyond the expense ratio, beyond the age of the product, and beyond the assets under management. Those are easy buttons to be able to do, but the better products, the better performing products are going to be driven by holdings. And we, again, we think investors can do that on their own. They can work with a third party like CFRA or other tools that are out there.
Again, we're visiting with CFRA's Todd Rosenbluth. Todd, we have a few minutes left before we let you go. We're now almost into May, which is hard to believe. What have been your 2 or 3 biggest ETF surprises this year? Whether positive or negative, these can be on flows, performance, launches, whatever. What's caught your attention?
So 55% of net inflows as of last Thursday went into fixed income ETFs.
Wow.
They're less than 20% of the overall market, but there's been demand, and it's been in a wide array of different areas. So TLT, which is a 20-year treasury product, has seen significant inflows in the month of April. We've seen BNDX, which is an international bond ETF that Vanguard offers. We've seen mortgage-backed securities, MBB, to name just a handful of the products that are leading the charts. And those are 3 different investment styles. We've seen short-term bond products that were very popular in 2018. Some of them are still gathering assets. The floating rate treasury product from WisdomTree, I think it's USFR is the ticker, JPST, JP Morgan Ultra Short Bond ETF, again, remaining popular. We're really pleasantly surprised that there's been broad adoption of fixed income ETFs. We cover over 200 of them here at CFRA, and we're really excited about the growth that's happening in that space. So that's one of the themes. I'll pause. I don't know how much time we have to either offer.
No, anything else on your radar?
Well, the second thing that is surprising is that even though the stock market is up over 15, close to 20%, using the S&P 500 as my reference point. Low volatility ETFs remain popular. They were popular in the fourth quarter of 2018 because investors got nervous. But SPLV from Invesco, USMV from iShares, among other min or low vol products, are really continuing to gather assets. It again shows you that not everybody is roaring into the bull market. We're heading into a time that tends to be seasonally weak in May, and investors may want to rotate into these strategies, but it seems like to some extent they've already been there for much of the year. And we're encouraged by that investors are staying loyal to some of the themes, even if the market is showing more of a risk-on environment. It shows you that, you know, some investors are using ETFs as trading vehicles, others are using them as a replacement for individual stocks or mutual funds as a core position, and reducing your risk profile has been quite popular within the equity space to start 2019, excuse me. We're almost in May, and I can't get the year right.
Well, Todd, we'll have to leave it there. Excellent stuff, as always. Really appreciate all the work you do covering ETFs. Look forward to visiting again soon. Thank you.
In here, you guys have a great rest of the show.
That was Todd Rosenbluth, Senior Director of ETF and Mutual Fund Research at CFRA. Again, one of the best in the business covering ETFs. Highly recommend giving him a follow on Twitter, at ToddCFRA. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll spotlight the brand new AdvisorShares Pure Cannabis ETF. We'll be joined by the portfolio manager, Dan Ahrens. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Nate and Connor in studio. Let's go right to our ETF Spotlight.
It's time for the ETF Spotlight, where each week we highlight one exchange-traded fund. There are thousands of ETFs available to invest in. ETF Prime has sorted through them all, so you don't have to.
The ETF we're spotlighting this week is the AdvisorShares Pure Cannabis ETF. The ticker symbol is YOLO, You Only Live Once. This just launched on April 17th, and joining us via phone from New York to discuss this ETF is Dan Ahrens, Chief Operating Officer at AdvisorShares. He's also the portfolio manager for this ETF. Dan, great having you back on the show.
Hey, thanks for having me on, guys.
So, Dan, a lot I want to cover, but let's start by having you take us through the ETF itself. This is the first U.S.-listed, actively managed ETF focused on cannabis. Tell us about your investment process and what exactly the ETF holds.
Certainly. Well, as you said, it's actively managed, especially in a new, fast-changing, fast-growing area like cannabis. We think it's incredibly important to be actively managed, to have a portfolio manager with eyeballs on this every day, as compared to blindly following an index. You know, S&P 500 index investing might be smart, but for a specialty fund like this, I would never want to be index-based. It's very important to be active. Now, as you said also, this is the first actively managed cannabis-focused ETF in the United States. We're domiciled in the United States, and we've been working on this for a very long time because we went through the full proper approval process with the SEC. We got a legal opinion written, and we had a great deal of dialogue with our custody bank, the same custody bank that does all the rest of AdvisorShares funds. But it's a very big deal to have a regular federal custody bank handling this ETF. It does an awful lot behind the scenes to make institutional investors comfortable, to make, as everybody that knows ETFs knows, the authorized participants comfortable. All that is working like a regular ETF would.
So, Dan, if we look into the ETF, give us a flavor for the types of stocks that are held. What exactly does this cover? It's called pure cannabis. So what does that mean?
Certainly. Well, as the name implies, we do want as much as possible pure cannabis exposure. We're not holding big tobacco. We're not holding some of those big alcohol companies that have begun to dabble in cannabis investments and those ancillary products like Scott's Miracle-Gro and so on. They're not in here. We're really focused on pure cannabis, which means the Canadian growers, agriculture companies. There's even a New York Stock Exchange listed REIT company in here, but it specializes in real estate for cannabis growth. Yeah, there's some pharmaceuticals and biotech in here, but we're not talking about the huge ones that might have a tiny piece of cannabis testing going on. We're talking about the smaller ones that are really specializing in cannabis and cannabinoids. Now, we are investing in companies listed on the New York Stock Exchange, listed on NASDAQ, listed on the Toronto and the Toronto Venture. But as we're not index-based, we're also not market cap weighted. So we do own some of those famous larger companies in this space, like Canopy and Tilray, Aurora, but they might not be our highest weighted holdings. Those companies already had big transactions. Some analysts and other people think, those may have been inflated somewhat. So if you look at our top five holdings, we have some very good Canadian growers and agriculture companies there, but it's more towards the smaller ones that might have the most upside potential from today and might have one of those big transactions in their future.
Dan, I think when a lot of investors think about the marijuana space, they think about recreational use. But of course, there are a lot of different applications involved here. Can you maybe talk about a few of those different applications in the cannabis space?
Yeah, certainly. And I touched on the fact that there's biotech and pharmaceutical going here. But even if you read the descriptions of some of the major Canadian growers, like we have a company called Organigram that's right in our top two or three holdings. Also, Green Organic Dutchman. These companies are, in general, doing business for recreational because that's legal in Canada. But some of them also have worldwide reach and distribution deals with other outside companies for medical use marijuana. Because, it gets very complicated. Again, Canada is the hot spot investing right now because of the recreational legalization. But there's countries around the world, a handful that have recreational use approved, but a much larger group that has medical use approved. And so when we look at these Canadian companies, we're looking at, what is their capacity and what is their reach? What's their distribution? And lots of medical use approved in various countries around the world.
Dan, I have to ask you on a lighter note, is there any backstory you can give us on the ticker symbol, YOLO? Were you involved with that at all? Or is that on the marketing side of the equation?
Oh, I'm always involved in tickers. Tickers are fun. But, we wanted a memorable ticker. A ticker that can easily roll off the tongue and people can associate with. A lot of funds out there are known by their ticker symbol. That's what people call the ETF. Some people call, the fund by other, short names or nicknames. So pure cannabis was very important to us, but YOLO was available. It had been previously associated with a marijuana company. But they gave up that ticker, and it might have been a Canadian ticker, though, but regardless. It was a fun ticker. We know it's a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but it's memorable, and it's easily associated. That's important.
What about just the name of the ETF, the Pure Cannabis ETF? I know Bloomberg recently had a piece explaining how the SEC is really keeping a watchful eye on ETF names, especially thematic ETFs. Was there any issue here, just given that YOLO is the first ETF with cannabis in its name?
Well, we're proud of that, too. But again, as I said, we went through a lot of due diligence working with all of our service providers and communicating, you know, openly and honestly with the SEC. And while it's not required, they asked for a legal opinion. We went out and got a legal opinion written. So I think there's a lot of silly names in the space, and we wanted to be straightforward with it. So why not call it cannabis? And if we want to focus on the fact that we don't own all that other stuff that people probably don't want, you know, in this fund, big tobacco and ancillary providers, this is pure cannabis. So we went with that name. And there's no reason you have to have some silly beat around the bush name if you are upfront and honest and communicate well with your service providers and the SEC.
Dan, it's Connor Kelly. For our listeners that are, you know, just learning about this space, obviously everybody understands the possibilities and prospects for legal recreational use and medical use for marijuana. But can you speak a little bit about the maybe the hopes or potential gains that can be seen in the pharmaceutical and biotech space?
Yeah, no, great question. And the other thing I want to stress that kind of goes hand in hand with, you know, I'm going to say this is probably going to be a volatile fund. This is a volatile space. So it's not for the weak at heart. But we think it has tremendous, tremendous upside potential in the long term. And we've even compared it to decades and decades ago when they ended prohibition on alcohol. I think we might be looking at a post-prohibition period in cannabis. Now, that said, the world's already changed a great deal in the past year or two. You know, I was on record, you know, just a year and a half, 2 years ago, saying a fund like this was not possible. There's really not enough to invest in that's publicly listed, liquid, large. Well, now there is. And there's been such a groundswell of support where people in the United States feel strongly that a banking law is on the way. At least decriminalization at a federal level might be on the way. You know, I don't know if we're ever going to have a, you know, full federal legalization because we have a lot of, you know, state by state approvals to happen in this country. But a federal decriminalization or banking law would be huge and only spur these stocks even more. On the other hand, I don't think we even need that. We have legal marijuana use, whether it's recreational or medical, in many countries around the world. We got huge growth in Canada, and they're still getting their footing. They're still having, you know, getting prices in order, things like this. You know, they need to get prices where they're more attractive or at least as attractive as buying it illegally as on the black market. This is still all its infancy. We're going to see more companies come in public. We're going to see consolidation. We're going to see M&A activity, and we're going to see a lot of these companies mature. Now, at that same time, I think investors need to be leery. And when you look at OTC stocks, penny stocks, which we don't invest in, everything we invest in is listed on a major exchange, but there's going to be pump and dump schemes. There's going to be fraud. There's going to be huge success stories, and there's going to be big failures. It's kind of the Wild West when you're looking at things, and that's why I think, you know, professional management and investing in, even though these are up and coming, you know, exchange-listed companies, and that's what we're investing in.
Dan, we only have about 2 minutes left here. I think you've done a really nice job of highlighting some of the risks involved here, right? Regulatory risks, just mentioning some of the, you know, potential fraud, penny stocks in the space. What about valuations of cannabis-related stocks? I think anytime you have an area with a lot of excitement, a lot of investor interest like we've seen with cannabis, you get words like bubble tossed around. And we have seen a little bit of that here, right? Any thoughts on valuations across the broader cannabis market?
Yeah. Well, we're going to have volatility, like I said. And with active management and portfolio trading, we might even take advantage of some of that volatility. I said we're not market cap weighted. We're not an index. So I still want to own Canopy because they're one of the biggest players here. I still want to own Tilray and Alfria. but they're not my highest weighted stocks. I own them a little bit lower down the grouping. I think some of the stocks I have in my top five or so might be really attractive, either for great growth in their future or M&A activity, some of these smaller up-and-coming companies. And there's a couple companies that I don't even own right now, like Kronos. Kronos is a big one. They had a big transaction with Altria. A lot of people think they might be a little frothy, bubbly, high priced versus their, you know, future growth prospects. So overall, you have to throw out old school fundamental investing. It's a little bit like looking at some technology stocks that aren't showing profits yet. Some of the PE ratios are outrageous. You can't really look at that. You have to look at the company's capacity, today's price versus the future growth prospects.
Well, Dan, with that, we're going to have to leave it there. Excellent spotlight today. Congratulations on the launch of YOLO. And we certainly look forward to visiting again as the space continues to evolve. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was Dan Ahrens, Chief Operating Officer at Advisor Shares. Again, the ETF is the Advisor Shares Pure Cannabis ETF. And you can learn more about this ETF by visiting advisorshares.com. That'll do it for today's show. I want to thank our exclusive sponsor, Legg Mason. You can visit leggmason.com to learn more about their broad range of investment strategies. Podcasts of ETF Prime are available at etfprime.com, etf.com, iTunes, and Spotify. You can follow me on Twitter, at Nate Geraci. Next week, we'll be joined by Karen Shinoni, fixed income product strategist at BlackRock. The topic will be bond ETFs. And then Thomas Cole, CEO of Distillate Capital, will spotlight their U.S. Fundamental Stability and Value ETF. Until then, have a great week, everyone.